Hello, Ray Wheatley. 5 years. I'm here with Father Dave. He's the Australian boxing manager of Solomon Egberime, who's currently fighting in the USA and after a world title shot. How are you, Father Dave?
Good to see you, Ray.
Good to see you too, Dave. Solomon Egberime, who boxed 2 weeks ago.
Beat
Gerardo Cuevas.
I still haven't seen the fight, but it seemed like it was very decisive.
Yeah.
Each of the judges gave him a clear. I think it was 7-1, 7-1, 6-2, which is a pretty clear.
He only lost one or two rounds on the fight.
Yeah, exactly.
So an 8-round fight.
He was very happy with it, and all the guys over there, so it was very decisive.
So he's managed by Joe Horn over there.
Yep.
And Joe Horn's got a big.
He's Lewis Tablers.
He feels he's going to go somewhere.
Joe's pretty new at the game. I think he was working with Paul Spadafora before, but I think, and that was a tough experience for him. I think he's feeling much more comfortable with Solomon. I think he took a chance on Sol, you know, getting him out there. He'd only saw him when Sol fought Spadafora in December 2012, but that was enough. He was impressed with Sol then. He was willing to take the chance of taking him on. He's, you know, put his money where his mouth is and given it a go, and he's very happy with the results so far. So it's just a question of finding the right fights for him, you know, over the next couple of months. They gave themselves a 6-month window, was the idea.
Okay.
And let's see what Sol can achieve in that time. I mean, Sol's got a lot of talent. He's still at the top of his game. He can't afford to let it go any longer. You know, he's not getting any younger. He's in his mid-30s, and it's got to happen now or never.
He was well-rated about 2 years ago.
He was ranked a couple of years ago. He's lost that ranking through inactivity, understandably. This is his chance to get it up and have his shot. And Sol knows and Joe knows that it's now or never.
So he's got Lewis Carpier training?
Yeah, Lewis is a great trainer.
Yeah.
And I think Lewis is going to bring the best out of him.
Yeah.
For sure.
Now you box yourself. You've had several fights yourself. Other day. When did you first start boxing?
I started after my marriage breakdown. Right.
How long ago was that?
1991.
1991. Okay.
Well, I got to start in kickboxing.
Started kickboxing first.
But yeah, look, boxing kick. The fight game proved. I was a martial arts background before then. And I've got a number of black belts and things in different arts, and I've done the stand-up fights and the wrestling side as well, so I've got a rounded experience in that. But the fight game for me was a very therapeutic experience. You know, I'll be quite frank with you, I reached a stage in 91 where I was drinking myself to sleep at nights, and I thought, well, what else do I do? I could see where this is going, you know.
So you were a father then?
Yeah, I was actually parish priest in Dulles Hill. It was my first year there.
Okay.
And, you know, with my wife and the daughter gone, you know, I thought, I can see where this is going. I thought, what else do I enjoy doing apart from drinking? I thought, well, I enjoy training. So I just started training like buggering, you know, and I was training somewhere every day. I was only part-time at the church at that stage, you see. I was supposed to be finishing a uni degree in social work, which I never finished. But I just, every spare minute I had, rather than getting into mischief, I started training. So I was training 7 days a week, and ended up being a professional fighter instead of an alcoholic.
There you go. It's a better choice.
Well, I think better, you know, I think I lost about the same number of brain cells.
You were pretty active last year in the ring.
Couple of fights last year. I'd left it go for a while, you know, and I thought, look, I've got to see if I've still got it in me. So I thought I'll give it another go. Was headed over to Adelaide for these Masters.
So you're 53 now, Dave?
53 now, you know, and I thought I better find out now whether I've still got it in me. If I have, I want to give it my best shot if there's still opportunities for further fights. And I didn't go in with very high expectations for myself last year, but I did a lot better than I anticipated. You know, I think just my fitness. So I fought Kev Selby, who was a very tough opponent.
Kev Selby is a top professional. You all trained with him?
Yeah, I was happy to hold my own with him, and then the fight with Barry Hancock, which I did well in, I thought.
All of your fights are on YouTube, right?
Yeah.
Anyone that wants to check them out, have a look on YouTube.
Yeah, I think the strength of that was I thought, okay, look, I can do better than this too. You know, so if I can find the right fights, I'd like to get a chance to have another shot. I know I'm 53, but I'd like to see if there's another 53-year-old out there that can get the
very, very fit. Now, you currently hold a world record for amount of rounds, 120 rounds. What year was that done?
2012, I think.
2012, 120 rounds?
Was it the same year? Yeah, it was April 1st, 2012.
How many different sparring partners?
66 different sparring
66
partners.
66 sparring partners.
So it was 3 minutes on, 1 minute break.
Congratulations.
I thought 12 rounds is the normal. I thought I'd do 10, 12.
Now, you get all the top professionals coming to your gymnasium. Over there, David Hill. You have Anthony Mundine, former super middleweight champ.
He's been very gracious in terms of supporting us in our fundraising activities and things. I've done some exhibition things with him. He was part of our 120-round thing. He's been
made a hand there.
Made as a mate. He's a good friend. And, he's been
supporting. Solomon O'Mana.
Solomon, I haven't seen for a little while. We were working with him very closely for a while, but he's. He certainly has been a part. He was part of our youth work as well for a while.
Who else have I missed out on, mate? Didn't mention. Who else has been over here?
Well, Solomon Egberime, you've mentioned already. They're probably the main guys. We had Lovemore with us for a while, as you know. They're the main. I mean, Solomon Egberime's been brilliant, you know. And the thing is, not only good having him train with us, but he's just brilliant with the kids. He's great with the kids.
You travelled with Solomon, you took him to Syria.
He came
to
Iran and to Syria with us, or to Syria through Iran.
Training the children?
Yeah, look, the idea was we wanted to get a feel for whether we could set up an ongoing sort of boxing program with the kids in Syria, you know, just to try and humanise the situation and build relationships at the grassroots.
Right.
I mean, I look at the role that boxing's played in, like, say, in South Africa and helping build the bridge between black and white people there historically, through the apartheid years. Or say in Northern Ireland, the role that boxing had in helping bring peace between the sort of warring factions there. I thought, boxing has had a historic role, in bringing together warring parties and getting them to subvert those energies into a sporting outlet. I thought, well, why not in Syria? I mean, why not in Gaza? Why not in a lot of places? So this is where the Boxers for Peace idea came from. And last year, Sol was willing. I said, how about we go in there together and we'll suss out, speak to the Syrian Olympic Committee if we can, speak to some of the boxers over there, see if we can set something up at the grassroots so we can have an ongoing relationship there.
Some of those training sessions are on YouTube too.
Yeah, we went over there and we just started boxing on the streets.
Yeah.
In fact, the first, I remember we were in Latakia, which had been a rebel-held area for a while, and I was in a meeting in there and I found Sol had already started outside. Just with kids were coming up to him, he was just working pads with the kids, teaching them how to box. It just started naturally. And then we were in another meeting, we're supposed to be inside this church in Homs, and someone said, why don't you just work? There's so many kids who want to just stay outside the church building. We said, we got our equipment there and just started working with kids. Well, suddenly we had hundreds of kids.
Yeah, fantastic.
Look, it's, as it was said there, the kids have got to learn to play again.
Yeah.
Some of those kids, we went in working with kids from Yarmouk. We weren't actually in Yarmouk in the refugee camp. We were the kids who were refugees from Yarmouk. They had to be moved out because their parents, they're all orphans. Parents had all been killed. All these kids want to do is go back to Yarmouk, which is ironic because all the people in Yarmouk want to do is go back to Palestine. But beautiful kids.
Yeah.
And again, it's just teach them to play again, I mean, we had a kid in a wheelchair there with his boxing gloves on, having a great old time, and it's so tragic.
You're going back there again very soon.
We're heading off there again within a month, yeah.
Best of luck on that great effort you
Well,
over
this
there.
Time we're going to make it. We're going to do some proper fights, hopefully, with some of the kids in the Syrian Olympic team.
Oh, good.
I don't think we'll do too well. We haven't got the calibre of... Well, we've got Bam Bam with us, Bam Bam Elmir, and she's a great fighter.
Yeah.
And we'll get some matches for her. We've got some other good fighters with us, but I don't think they'll be of the calibre of some of the Syrian Olympic members. I hope that I'm going to get some fights myself. I don't know against who.
Well, you'll be a handful for anyone.
Well, as long as they're my age or close to it, I'll be fine. But
you look terrific, mate.
Look, we'll see how it goes, but... In a sense, this is the first time we tried something like this. I'm hoping we seem to have the Syrian Olympic Committee on board, and I think they're keen to see it make it work. We spoke to the head of the Olympic Committee last time, and he was mad keen. And understand, and if we can create relationships at the grassroots, what I mean? Look, I say the front door of politics is a difficult one to get through, but the back door of religion and sport is wide open. So let's go through there and let's show the Australian community the other side of Syria. You know, it's not just death and bloodshed. There's just a lot of good people there just trying to get on with their lives. You know, maybe we can build relations there, you know, and do something together.
Well, wishing you a great trip and your next trip to Syria, mate. Let's have a talk when you get back, Dave.
I look forward to it, brother.
Best of luck. Always good to talk to you, Dave.
And you, my friend.
Cheers, mate.